And we're very fortunate today to have our hero keynote speaker, Wang, Associate Professor at Stanford University Center for Computer Research in Music and Acoustics, co-founder of Smule, the designer of the Ocarina and Magic Piano apps for mobile phones. You're also architect of the Czech audio programming language, the director of the Stanford Laptop Orchestra, and so on. The list goes on forever. So this, I'm so thrilled. I'm so excited to have you here today. And among other things, the author of Artful Design Technology in Search of the Sublime, a photo comic book. And I actually have a copy right here. That's awesome.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you for joining. Gay, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Really happy to be here and thank you for having me. And thanks, hey, everyone out there.
Thank you. I was lucky to have purchased this book at a conference in Silicon Valley 2019. It has become my true companion, the source of inspiration ever since. While I was, you know, we were working on developing our startup, developing ideas, the concept, and building a prototype. And Gay, I've been meaning to ask you, what inspired you to choose the comic form for this book? That I've had this question since 2019, so maybe you can answer that.
Okay, well, first of all, I'm so honored that you've read the book. Not only that, it looks like you've made many notes. I'm so honored as an author. I'm really over the floor. Thank you for reading. And as for why it's a comic book, I grew up with reading comic books. Actually, when I was growing up in Beijing, where I was born and raised and until I was nine, I would read The Adventures of Tintin, among other things, kind of translated into Chinese and sold on these fairly inexpensive penny dreadfuls that you buy on the newspaper stands and the streets. But I was engrossed. Those stories have always stayed with me, as well as the kind of storytelling that's part of that. So it seemed like an interesting way to write a design book. And where in design, the medium, of course, you know, pervades and modulates, and in many ways it almost exceeds the message. So in its power to actually shape you know, communities and even societies. And so it seems like by experimenting with the medium, it was a different way to kind of talk about design.
That's certainly a very cool way. You're right. I bookmarked all the book with so many great ideas. And that's why I'm so excited to have you here today, you know, to talk about the technology in search of the sublime, to talk about the art and tech. So the new kinds of, you know, technology that's been developed and how they're being used by artists, for artists in the society, how we can amalgamate art and tech. And I know, so we're first doing your presentation. I give the floor over to yours and then to you. And then we have a short break. And after that, Gay will join our panel discussion on art and tech together with other speakers. So I guess we're all ready. And I will give the floor over to Gay.
Here we go. Thanks so much, Laura. And thanks, everyone, for joining. I'm just going to jump right in, and I will talk about Artful Design Technology in Search of the Sublime. And please do feel free to, in whatever streaming chat you have, feel free to comment or ask questions. And here's look forward to Laura, and I'll also be able to see it then in Zoom chat. So please feel free to keep the conversation rolling. So that's me. And this is where I work. And that is Stanford University. And actually, my building in which I work is in this picture. It's not what's pictured in the front, and that's Memorial Church. I work in that building under the chimneys way in the back of campus. And that is Stanford's Center for Computer Research in Music and Acoustics. It's abbreviated CCRMA, and it's sometimes pronounced KARMA. And that's me in my office. In fact, that's actually where I am right now. And what is it that I do here? I make things. I'm a tool builder. I create things like programming languages for music, musical instruments, VR experiences, AI systems with humans in the loop, toys and games and other tools. So software has always been kind of my kind of go-to craft and tool to build more tools. I've been coding since college. And that was actually in the 90s. And I was a computer science major, but I was always interested also in the arts. And for me, it was really like, it's music. It's also visuals. It's also just this idea of kind of human expression. And why do we do it? What does it mean to do it well? And how do we build tools that enable ourselves and communities perhaps to actually be more artful and expressive? This is the aforementioned Chuck programming language. It's open source, it's freely available. If you go to chuck.stanford.edu, you can begin downloading this and making your own computer music actually within minutes. And there are a lot of, I'll say more about this later, but this is the Stanford Laptop Orchestra, which I direct. And this is also a lab, one of my labs here. It's the Stanford VR Design Lab. And I'll have more to say about that in about 20 minutes. But before I go into that, I want to give you just a bit more of who I am. And I think I exist day to day in these like different modes. For example, there is a mode that is very much all about technology. And in this mode, well, I work day in, day out with technology, mostly software, a lot of hardware, a lot of actually signal processing and acoustics. So, and a lot of just kind of the science, and I would say the art of engineering and tool building. Then I guess there's this other side of me, which is almost like kind of the opposite in some ways. It's like hiking, it's hike. If tech is indoors mostly, and for me, and where I'm kind of in front of a computer all the time, this is in the great outdoors. And I actually do quite a bit of hiking nowadays. And actually before COVID and before quarantine, I was like very, very much like just preferred sitting on the couch. I like to sit on the couch. I like to just play video games in a gaming chair. But after maybe a year and a half of quarantine, my partner, Madeline, says, we gotta go outside. And she somehow dislodged me from the gaming chair and the couch. And we went and did a lot of hiking. And last summer, we actually ended up doing the 210-mile John Muir Trail here in California in the High Sierra. And in fact, I have just, 50 seconds video of what, a taste of what that's like. In fact, that's actually part of a 2-hour documentary on YouTube called On the Devil's Road, John Muir Trail. So if you, after this, if you're like, oh, I wanna see what more, what that's all about, please do check that out. But here's a taste of it.
And now for a taste of things to come.
Fucking piles of rocks.
Yeah. So what do you think about that? In fact, it's pretty honest. I think anyone who's been on the trail, I think can relate. This was kind of the ultimate in like what someone called type 2 fun. Type 1 fun is like fun you're having and you realize you're having fun and you're like, this is so fun in the moment. Type 2 fun is like, well, you might be like really miserable in the moment. Like here, it's a lot of rocks. It's in the wilderness. You're high in the mountains. If you're not going up a mountain, you're probably going down a mountain with a lot of rocks and mosquitoes and everything else. But in the aggregate, it is so rewarding and it feels rewarding, but it's miserable in the moment. So type two fun is fun that you have kind of almost in retrospect. And this is that, and it's really kind of a transformative experience, but it also reminds me of this meme. Remember not long ago, for those of us that were alive, like 20 years ago, the internet was an escape from the real world. This is what you did to kind of forget about life for a while. Now life is kind of on the internet, more or less, and the real world is an escape from the internet. So as you can see, that even though this is not ostensibly about technology or art, this hiking side of me, it is very much part of who I am. And it's also something I juxtapose, like side by side with all the technology that I work with. And I think this introduces a kind of perspective about why we do things and how much we should do things, and also what life, you know, could be about, and what the mix. I think it asks the question, what's the right balance, the right mixture of tech and no tech and other things? Because you know what, on the trail, there's not a lot of tech. We have quite a bit of technology, to be honest, you know, from the GPS to the fairly lightweight gear that we were able to procure. But relatively, it's pretty low tech. But life was good. And then another side of me is art, and art making. This is the Stanford Laptop Orchestra, and I write music. Also, I consider tool building itself to be a kind of art. And so for me, like, this is a side that's about really about expression, right? And expression, but also building tools that help to process our life. I think if you think of art as a tool, I think, and you ask, well, if it's a tool, what is it for? Maybe art is a kind of tool that helps us to really process what's happening to us in this life, right? And to process our relationship with one another. So there's a lot of ways we can think about that. And then there's, you know, life. Which I think is all of these things kind of added together. Life is all of these things, I think, is part of life, right? In whether it's tech, for me, it's hiking, it's also art, but they combine into this thing we call life. And for me, like, all of that is part of the development of me as someone who designs. And so for me, life, it's not separate. There's not like a separate compartment where I be like, okay, well, now I'm living my life versus now I'm going to be doing design. And I think it's these kinds of, I guess, ruminations and philosophical thinkings, and frankly, a lot of coding and doing and thinking about the things we build, that led me to write this aforementioned book, Artful Design, Technology in Search of the Sublime. And as Laura said, it's a comic book. All 488 pages of it. It's a photo comic book. And I think in the aggregate, I think what it's trying to do is basically pose and try to address, or at least begin to address, three questions. One question is, what is the nature of design? Right? If it's artful design, what is the nature of design? And that the short answer I have for you there is that for me, everyone is a designer. You don't need design in your title. You don't even need to think of yourself as a designer. I think by virtue of being human, we all design. Anytime we intentionally shape the world around us with a purpose in mind, that I call design. And by that definition, I think every last one of us are designers. And if you think of it in a similar way, who among us is not some kind of architect for some version of the future, right? And it could be our own future, could be that of our friends or family or community. And for those of us that have the power to shape even beyond that, like, how do we want to design parts of our society, right? So nature of design, we all do it. It's an intentional shaping of the world by the definition I'm taking in Artful Design. And then I think the next question is, this is the artful question. This is one of the artful questions. What does it mean to design well, right? It's, we can think about design, and often we think about design as like, well, it needs to serve a function. And then we need to be like, let's hope it doesn't do any harm. That's actually really important. But this is the other side of that coin is that, okay, yeah, hopefully we make things that serve the function, and hopefully we also make, in serving this function, we really are cognizant of the complexity of building tools for the human world. This question is related to that, and say, what does good look like? Third question: in this age of so much technology, and also, frankly, so much human discord, what does it mean to design ethically? So those are the three overarching questions for the book. So I want to now give you a demo of something I designed. This is Ocarina, and the way it works is, I'm going to go ahead and just play this for you. And it is an app for the phone. And I'm going to launch it right now. And the way you play it is you blow into the phone. And you can control pitch with the multi-touch on the screen. And you can play little ditties with this. For example, right? So that's Ocarina. And if you look at the design of Ocarina, it is not complex. In fact, it's quite simple. And I would actually say it's often in design, it's hard to make things simple and still have it be not simplistic, right? So this is always the challenge. In this case, we did land on a fairly simple design, in that you don't actually see like the outer shell or casing of an ocarina. You just see the buttons that control pitch. The green waves are visualizations of your breath. When you blow into the microphone, which is, by the way, how this works, the software inside is basically doing signal processing on the audio signal that's coming through on the microphone. And that's going to control a sound synthesis model that's generating the sound. So the sound you're hearing in Ocarina is not pre-recorded. It's synthesized live and in real time and interactively on the device. But also in making this simple, it's also trying to make a different kind of statement, right? Because, you know, well, usually how do we use a font? Well, maybe like this or like that. But here it's like we're asking users to, hold their phone like a sandwich and blow into it. And I think that's a very physical thing, but also, in this kind of simplicity, I think it's making the argument in the tool, without saying as much, that your phone isn't emulating an ocarina. By actually running this app, your phone has become a physical ocarina. And I think that changes the way you would think about using this thing. It changes about how you would use this thing. It changes the context in which you would use this thing. And as far as the signal processing, this is what it looks like. I'm not going to go into that here, but just to know that this is how we generate the sound in Ocarina kind of internally. And I think there are a lot of questions we could ask. In fact, as tool builders, as creatives, as artists, it's always a good idea to continually examine ourselves and the things we make. As in, like, what do we build? How did this thing really come about? For whom is this really for? And how does this affect not only behavior, but how, if people use this thing or engage with this thing enough, how does it change their pattern of life? These are all questions, I think, to continually contemplate, even as we're building, and maybe even especially after we've built the thing. So here's a question, you know, something like Ocarina, like, what is it even? Is it an instrument? Is it a toy? And what makes something an instrument versus a toy? So maybe I'll leave this question now, you know, for y'all to think about, and feel free to put any, if you're thinking, into chat. There's no right answer here, really. And there's no wrong answer either. It's kind of how you think about it. So for those of you that are like, I think it's an instrument, maybe you're thinking it's an instrument because you can make music with it, but two, it's controllable. And three, better at playing this thing through practice. Maybe these are all things that would say that would make it a kind of instrument. And those are all more or less true of ocarina. It's something that, because the sound is generated live, you can really learn to be expressive in your own way. You can learn to get better at playing this instrument. But then is it a toy or also a toy? For those of you that think, well, it's a toy in the sense that it's playful, that it doesn't need to serve a purpose beyond just the experience of playing it, then maybe it's a toy. So it kind of depends. Maybe it's both. Maybe it's one or the other. Maybe it's neither. But it's a good question to think about. This is ocarina in gameplay mode. And as you can see, ocarina is really, it's really kind of not just a sound making thing, right? In the design of this thing, it's audio that's generated, it's real time computer graphics, it's visuals. And there's a correspondence between what you hear and what you see. And thirdly, it's interactive, right? There's stuff you need to do to it, with it. There are things you need to interact with. So this is both audiovisual design as well as interaction design. But the hope is you kind of design a thing where these three different elements aren't separate, but rather contribute to a single unity, to a single thing. And that's the hope with this kind of design for something like ocarina. And by the way, as a gameplay mode, the circles that fall down the middle of the screen, these quadruplets, they're actually kind of hinting as to how you would play the next note. So in that, it's kind of like Guitar Hero or Rock Band. But the difference between this and between ocarina and Guitar Hero is that the sound in ocarina, as I said, is not pre-recorded, which means you have a lot of room for open expression. And if you're playing it this way, actually, there's no notion of a correct tempo. You get to go as fast or as slow as you want. You can also speed up or slow down if you want, for expressive purposes. So, that's ocarina in gameplay mode. Now, there's another dimension to ocarina, and it is a social dimension. In the same app in ocarina, you can listen to other people blow into their phones from around the world. You know, who is that? O Shenandoah from the East Coast. Or how about this? This is a Legend of Zelda from Indonesia. Who are these people? Well, the app is not designed to tell you. In fact, the app was designed to not tell you. Because, well, I guess the theory And the curiosity here for the designer was that I think this changes the experience if you don't know, because if you don't know, it makes you wonder. And to wonder is actually it's part of the experience. Because you then begin to construct stories in your mind about who that might be. If you hear Legend of Zelda from Indonesia, or if you hear Final Countdown playing from Korea, you're like, oh. And why is that a traveler? Because there are no answers, you continue to ask the questions, and that becomes part of the experience, right? So sometimes actually refraining from features can be Well, it will change the experience. And sometimes, you know, I'm not saying it's better or worse, it's different. And knowing, and the other part is that you can't, you can have this notion of loving something you hear by hitting that love button at the top left, but there's no way to actually see how many people loved whatever is on the globe, right? These are just people playing, blown to their phones from around the world. And, but there's no, it's like a one-way street. So knowing that people can't see how many people liked their performance, the only reason you would hit that love is because you simply love it. And it changes this kind of expectation and also the reason we might have for putting anything, for interacting with things on the globe, right? So in some sense, this is kind of an anonymous social network based on music. And if there's another, you know, kind of question we could ask about this was, you know, in fact, why was this thing designed? Like, you know, if the first question is, what is it? The second question is, how did this come about? And why was it designed? Like, why was the thing even designed? And part of that, you know, you can ask, who do we design it for? Well, to be very honest with you, nobody asked for this. And it solves no problems that exists. And this is true. It's kind of almost a confession I'm making. But it also, I think, says something about kind of what kind of a thing this is and really why was this designed. This is not the these are not the reasons this was designed. And that might seem strange, because if you think about design as, you know, how we think about design in this day and age, it's like, yeah, design is here to solve a problem and we should, like, you know, we should try to solve the right problem. But like, design is basically providing a solution to a problem. But what if there's like no problem that exists? And why is that, you know, why would you build this? And this is, you know, it's not like we took a survey here and be like, hey, people, we're building an app. What should we build? And people are like, yeah, we need to blow into our phones. That's really missing in our lives, to play music. And we need to be able to listen to other people around the world play music through this app. No, it did not happen that way. This is not what you might call need-based design. It was not designed because there was a clear and present need for it, but it was designed for a different reason. I would call this a kind of values-based design, in the sense that this is not designed out of clear and present need, but out of a deep belief in something. And in this case, the belief, the value, if you will, was the belief that music making does a person good. That's the value, right? And it is related, I suppose, to, you can say, a human need, but it's not so clear. It's not front of mind, right? It's not like there's a hole in the ground, we need to fill this, but this is more of a additive thing for the world, right? And so that was the intention. And values-based design is something that you can do once you realize what might be good, and you do your very best to bring something into the world that, and you're curious in how that would make things better, even if it doesn't solve a problem that's clear and present. And to be honest, I will say right here, like in artful design, the idea is that you do the synthesis of both. Design is forever kind of about needs and solving problems. And there's a kind of intrinsic element to it, something that is an end in itself, that I would call it's the values, the things that you really believe in. Because even if you don't think about doing, your values, for better or for worse, will come through in any way in the things you make. So in this sense, like, I am thinking about tool building, which is more like design and engineering, but more like art, which is always about values, right? And it's complicated, but it's always about something that you care to really frame or post questions about, and to give people a lens to think through, just to see the world through. That's all part of this, what I would call values-based design. And here's a value for us, and it's about technology, right? And this is actually very much was in the, I guess, underlying philosophy of something like Ocarina. And it's this idea that technology should create calm, right? Mark Weiser, who rather famously coined this idea back in the 90s, he was the chief technology officer of Xerox PARC some three decades ago, which is actually that very, really kind of a legendary at this point research center that helped to really develop a lot of the personal computing paradigms that we now use and just kind of take almost for granted today of like, yeah, of course it should work that way. If this is how mouse and desktops and things could work. And so a lot of that technology, but also kind of thinking of how we could frame technology in our everyday lives through computing, you know, much of it we are indebted to Xerox PARC, which is Xerox Palo Alto Research Center, and to its late CTO, Mark Weiser, who had this notion that computers could be invisibly helping us. They don't need to be in our faces all the time. I mean, I think these things are in our faces all the time. So maybe that part has not come to pass, but the vision is still there. But also this idea that, you know, it's a remarkable statement in that it's not saying technology people is going to solve all our problems or technology is going to create wealth, but rather, or maybe in addition, technology could and should, ought to create a kind of inner peace in our lives. And what if that was the role of technology, right? This is from a user comment left in the App Store for Ocarina back in 2009. I'll read it. This is my piece on Earth. I'm currently deployed in Iraq. And hell on Earth is an everyday occurrence. The few nights may have off, I'm deeply engaged in this apt globe feature that lets you hear everybody else in the world playing the most calming art I've ever been introduced to. It brings the entire world together without politics or war. It is the exact opposite of my life. Deployed U.S. soldier. What do we make of this? Well, I can tell you as the designer, this was very incredibly humbling. Like, we knew we were making a playful thing, a musical thing, a whimsical thing even. But to see that we may have brought maybe like a temporary moment of peace to someone in a very harrowing situation, that was something else, right? And this leads me to think about design in this way. And I think this is trying to answer this question of what makes design artful, right? We talk about artful design, but what makes design really artful? Well, I'd say good design is, at the end of the day, has to be useful. It enables us, but maybe we can go beyond. Great design, or maybe you can think of it as artful design, is something that understands us as human beings, as people, as communities, right? Maybe that is what it means for design to be artful. And this is not I don't think this is not a complex concept for any of us, because this kind of understanding I'm speaking of, I think we all know. Think about your favorite song, your favorite movie, your favorite interaction with another person. These are things that understand us. They get us. They understand something about who we are, who we were. They understand something about our relationship with another person, right? So I think, what if our tools, our technology, similarly understood us as art does? And that, I think, is the question of, I think, in artful design. So this is the Artful Design Manifesto, which you'll find at the beginning of the book. And I'll read this for you. And I want you to think about not so much this particular manifesto or even artful design, but think about kind of how this relates to technology and tools and the way that you live and the parts of it that you wish could be different, right? So here it is. In our age of rapidly evolving technology and unyielding human restlessness and discord, design ought to be more than simply functional. It should be expressive, socially meaningful, and humanistic. Design should transcend the purely technological, encompass the human, and strive for the sublime. What is sublime design, you ask? Well, sublime design presents itself first and last as a useful thing, but nestled within that window of interaction lies the novel articulation of a thought, an idea, a reflection, an invisible truth that speaks to us, intimate yet universal, purposeful without necessity of purpose, that leaves us playful, understood, elevated. It is a transformation so subtle that it escapes our conscious grasp, that once experienced, like music, we would never want to be without again. Design should be artful. That is the manifesto. And I think in the context of how we are shaping technology, this is the space, this is to say we should design our technology. And maybe we should have always designed our technology such that in the same way we'd make art. And how would the world be different if we really were mindful about how we did that, right? And again, I do make kind of a distinction between what I would call design and what I might call art, is that, you know, I think the difference is that design really does have to serve a kind of extrinsic purpose, clear and present ones or other needs, whereas art is more abstract in kind of its purpose in that sense, in that it can exist for its own sake, right? But artful design in some ways kind of combine these two sides. And I think, you know, this goes on is a way to think about the tools in our lives. You know, how do the tools, the experience of using the technology of this day and age on Earth 2022, how does that make you feel? And how do you want to feel? Right. And what would like a good, what would be artful, what would like an artfully designed technology or tool, how do you want that to make you feel? Sometimes we think about design, we're like, well, it should be delightful, it should be joyful. And I agree with that. Right. But I think this is about more than sparking joy, as much as I'm a huge fan of sparking joy. But I think I, for one, would love technology and the experience of engaging with technology, of using it, to make me feel included, safe, free to be myself, understood. What if that was kind of how we went about designing tools, no matter what purpose the tool might be, you know, might serve? So, laptop orchestra is this kind of thinking that pervades all the things we design and all the ways we kind of do the research, but also just design everything from toys to tools to games to VR experiences to products, right? So this is a laptop orchestra, which here at Stanford is basically an ensemble of laptops, but also humans and special hemispherical speaker arrays. Here we see Kelly actually performing with one of these speaker arrays on her lap. She's actually playing it in a kind of computer-based trumpet-like instrument. You can even see that she has her coat over half of the speaker as a kind of a trumpet mute. On her right hand is a game track controller that's able to sense the 3D location of her right hand, and she's controlling aspects of the instrument. Basically, it's actually a polyphonic instrument that she's controlling with the keyboard on the laptop. But the sound crucially comes from her through the speaker that's basically, like in this case, almost part of her. So a station in the laptop orchestra looks something like this then. It's a laptop sitting on an audio interface, sitting on a breakfast tray that came from IKEA, by the way. And we sit on meditation mats and pillows, and we have these hemispherical speaker arrays. And their job is to keep sound local to the instrument. And we, by the way, also built these out of IKEA salad bowls, 11-inch Blanda mat, in case you're curious. We drilled holes into them, put amplifiers in them, and put car speaker drivers, 4-inch car speaker drivers into these with 6 channels that are independently addressable within each of these speakers. And we set about going to write music for this. But before I move on, I want to say that by doing it this way, by kind of flipping the kind of computer music, the way that we typically hear computer music inside out, that is, we don't hear music in the laptop orchestra from like speakers or PA systems around us. we hear them from these point sources or approximations of point sources that each one will be paired to a human. And it's the idea that if we're to be in the same physical room and someone plays like a violin, right? The violin naturally doesn't come from speakers around the room. It comes from that person, from that artifact, from the violin. So this is both trying to use cutting edge technology that's, you know, the computer, but pairing it with this very human, this very physical, very present, sonically present, and even intimate form of sound emanation. And that seemingly small difference actually has profound implications, because it would change immediately the way you would design an instrument. You would write music for an instrument. You would consider what it means to be an audience, right? It changes how you would play the instrument. It changes like everything. It's a butterfly effect from this one design difference and intention in making sound emanate from inside out. And we have premiered now more than 300 pieces for the laptop orchestra. In fact, if you go to slorp.stanford.edu, you can find the Stanford Laptop Orchestra, and also a second is laptopera.org. We're actually premiering a laptop orchestra opera in mid-November, November 11th, 12th, and 13th. And the laptop orchestra is really taking this idea and thinking about what kind of music can we make. So I'm going to play you just a little snippet from a piece called Twilight. And here we're using that same controller that's sensing the location of our hands. And here we're kind of have this gesture where we're sort of pulling sound out of the ground. And that was a laptop orchestra. Now for something completely different. This also has been used in the laptop orchestra. This is a laptop accordion. A good question here that might be in your mind is like, why? why a laptop accordion? This is kind of spiritual, like successor to something like the ocarina, in that this is a very everyday computing device used in an unconventional, playful way. And it's definitely not something anyone asked for, or I don't think this serves any like needs that are absent in our world. But it's playful. It's a way to make music. It's a way to be expressive. And how does this work? It's the front side camera going into optical flow computer vision algorithm that's basically just getting a rough measure of how fast we're opening and closing the lid on the laptop. This is almost certainly bad for, you know, the hinge on your laptop screen, but such is research, I suppose. And sound is generated on the computer. Right, it's already a computer, so we can just use it to make computer music. And then there's a VR lab. And every day in the VR lab looks something like this, where we are just experimenting with, here's a two-person violin. You know, Kyle is in VR. He's a one-string violin. He's almost like the violin body. And I'm actually the bow. And I have a controller in my hand, and the faster I bow, the more energy is put into the system, for example. And we've developed tools like Tunity, which is Chuck, that's the computer music language for Unity. And that's the kind of this environment for creating high performance, you know, graphics and interaction in games. And I want to show you something that my PhD student Kung Woo Kim did. And this is, he made a musical city in which all the different elements kind of have a musical function. So you can turn on the lights on the building, and these control algorithmic generated processes. And there's an audiovisual correspondence here where whatever you hear, you also see, and vice versa. The Ferris wheel controls tempo. The faster it turns, the faster the music goes. And when things really get going, we are going to go to the moon. Let me go back here and show you that. And on the moon, there are rabbits. These rabbits are making rice cake, and from their concoction comes a musical chord train. And this train is going to flow back through the city. How do you feel? That's my question to you in experiencing this. And by the way, this is an interactive thing, even though you're watching a recording of it, but it feels even different when you are, of course, playing it. UFOs come out of the sky, they're here to play music together. And at the end of the evening, everything peacefully turns off, the UFOs scatter, and we are ready for the next day. How does this make you feel? Well, there's no right answer to that. I can tell you that for me, it makes me feel like I want to live in a place that makes me feel like that. So to summarize and to really end this exploration of artful design, this final section, I do want to bring up a couple of questions, because we have to think about a couple of things. One, this idea that design is actually all about choices, right? It's a sequence. And sometimes a kind of a network of choices that I think must be thought about and thought through. And in this age of technology, that third question, what does it mean to design ethically, right? Is ethics of technology about, I don't know, doing no evil, as in do no harm? And is that the end? Is that really what ethics entail? Is that all it encompasses? Or does it also ask the question, how do we do good with it? And I would add that these two ideas are not the same. I would contend that there's a world of difference between do no harm, which is admittedly incredibly important and necessary, albeit very difficult, and proactively doing good, which I think, for better or for worse, would result in a vastly different outcome than do no evil. And maybe there's something that we can do in tandem, these two ideas. But this third question may well be the question, the ethical and aesthetic question of our age, as far as technology is concerned, how do we want to live with it? How do we want to live with our technologies? And that is an ethical question. I would say it's also an aesthetic question. And through our technologies, how do we want to live with one another? That, I think, has been and will continue to be one of the questions for our species, especially now as we have more technology than we've ever had. So artful design, if we believe any of this, then perhaps there has to be an artistic leap on the part of the designer that results from seeing and feeling the world at large. Designers are less problem solvers, more artists, philosophers, engineers, the useful things to understand. And what if that was what it means to design? Not so much just let's go find problems to solve. No, this is like, yeah, you got to try to find where needs are, but at the same time, it's about being a kind of artist in everyday life and striving for kind of everyday poetry. And the way you do that is you feel the world at large. And you can ask it questions, but a lot of times the impetus is on you to also figure out what the world really wants from itself, because that's not an easy question. And this is the kind of thing that artists have always done, right? But this is like one of our tools. We're made like we make art. So if this is true, then how we think about technology has to evolve. And how we educate ourselves need to evolve. Tomorrow's designer under this model, I think, has to be much more than a specialist, but a kind of technological artist, a moral ethical inventor, and a system designer who can contextualize what they make into the system, the context, the communities, and even societies for which it's been designed. So I think I see a question, which, in my words, would you say the engineering design art merge? Yes, I actually absolutely am saying that, is that not only do they merge, is that they should never have been taken apart. And I want to show you a way to think about that actually here. So I'm a teacher. And in higher education, we ask ourselves, you know, what kind of a student do we want to educate? For example, here at Stanford, right? And as I said, I was a computer science undergrad. I'm a PhD in computer science, but my home appointment here at Stanford is in music. I have a courtesy appointment in computer science. So I'm kind of one of these citizens of no place. But also at the same time, I love computer science. I love music. I love the humanities. I love anthropology, sociology. I love media studies, I love history, philosophy, literature. I love drawing. All of these things I love. And so this question of what kind of a person do we want to educate? We usually like, well, we don't want a I-shaped person. Like the letter I is just depth. And as a computer scientist, I can tell you it's really possible. It's all too easy to just get zeroed in on one discipline, trying to catch up with just the machine learning literature, AI literature that's coming out in like a span of a week. And you might never finish. Like there's just so much stuff out there, but yet the narrowness of this is potentially detrimental. That's the belief. So we thought like maybe we should educate more like T-shaped people, right? You have depth and then you have breadth. In Artful Design, I have this notion of a pie-shaped person, where on one leg is disciplinary expertise. For me, that was computer science. On the other leg is domain expertise. But this top bar is what I would call aesthetic lenses. It's a philosophical, artistic, and moral lens that gives broader meaning and context in bridging the two legs. And this is why I think engineering, some call it design, art, the humanities, the social sciences, like these are things that not only should be put back together, but they like should never have been taken apart, right? These are things that just should always be done in, you know, kind of together. So to end, I want to give you one final example. This is from our app, Sing, used to be called Glee Karaoke. And in 2011, in the wake of the earthquake and tsunami disaster in Japan, a woman reached out from Tokyo with a rendition of Lena. Now, like Ocarina, you can listen to other people sing on the globe, but you can also choose to, in this app, add your voice in a plus one kind of a way. When she did this and invited the world to sing with her, 4,000 people joined in the span of weeks. This is what it sounds like at about 1,000 people. that's artful design in a nutshell, I suppose. And with this, and this is what begins and ends the book, is this idea that what we make actually comes back to make us, to shape us as individuals and as communities. And knowing this, you know, could we design better? And in a nutshell, this is what my students work on. It's designed to kind of, to, with the purpose of helping us to flourish as individuals, as communities, and, you know, and to ask better and better questions about what that even means. And for that, you need the engineering, you need the humanities, you need the social sciences, you need art. So this is Artful Design, and hit me up at artful.design. That's the URL, and we put that into chat. And also, for those who are interested, here's a QR code you can scan that will take you there. And with this, I think we might be running a little behind on time, Laura, but we can either take a question or two here, and then maybe we can transition on to the panel where I'm also gonna, I guess I'm also on the panel, so we can also save some of the questions for there in the interest of time. Thank you so much, everyone, for having me.
Thank you so much for being here.